Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Welfare Reform Committee for 2015. Can I remind members to ensure that the mobile phones and other electronic devices are switched to airplane mode or silent as they can interfere with broadcasting. We have apologies today from our convener Hugh Henry and also apologies from John Lamont and Neil Finlay. And we welcome John's substitute Alec Johnson to committee and Neil's substitute Neil Bibby. And the first agenda item is a change to published agenda. And the first item of business is a declaration of interests. And I invite Neil Bibby to declare any interests that are relevant to the committee's remit.
No relevant interest to declare.
Welcome the members to committee this morning. Item two is business in private. The second item of today's business is a decision on taking item four, discussion of our post-Christmas work programme in private. It appears as item three in the published agenda. Can I have that agreement from the members? Thank you very much. And I move to item three on the agenda, which is oral evidence session on the future delivery of social security in Scotland. Today's session will focus on the housing element of universal credit, discretionary housing benefits, top-ups and new benefits. And today we will have two panels. The first panel will contain housing sector representatives, and I welcome before us today Mandy Morrison, operations manager with Quarriers, Allan Gunn, the head of revenues and business support for Highland Council, Jeremy Hewer, policy advisor of Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, Ashley Campbell, policy manager of the Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland, and Jules Oldham, who is representing Homeless Action Scotland. And we have apologies from Julie Hunter, housing strategy manager of North Lanarkshire Council. We've about an hour or so for the first panel, and I'm going to kick off question today by just asking about one of the major changes of universal credit, which is the element of moving to monthly payments. And if I could just open that as a sort of opening question to the panel about how they think the change to monthly payments will impact on delivery of service. Alan, thank you.
Highland Council went live with universal credit in November 13 for singles and couples in June 14 and February 14 for families. In terms of impact, in terms of financial, just now there's about 90% of council properties that are with UC in payment are in arrears. 90% is a significant number, although when you consider there's about 170-odd cases with UC against about a council house stock of about 13,000. In terms of materiality, it's not a significant sum, but in terms of the 90%, it is quite a significant sum, and I think that is generally attributable to the move to paying people less frequently, i.e. Every month. I think some of the claimant feedback we've found as part of the rollout across Highland is that the customers have found the move not just to monthly, but combined with paying direct to the claimants as well. It's been quite a change for them, whereas before it was paid fortnightly to the landlords. It's moved very swiftly to paying monthly to the claimants, and I think it's a combination of a few of those things that's contributed to some of the arrears that we're seeing. In terms of the profile and trend, the rent arrears with cases have been about 89% at the end of June, 90% at the end of September, and it was about 88% at the end of April, so there's not been that much change. So we seem to be sitting around the 90% mark. We'd also say in terms of some of the local housing associations such as Alban and Highland, the rent arrears figure is about 88% for UC claimants, whereas for housing benefit claimants is about 43% that's paid fortnightly with GSA.
Ms Morrison, thanks.
With regards to our family support services, a lot of the families we work with, the people are in work, but generally it's low-paid, unskilled work, and they're used to getting paid weekly or fortnightly. So while the rationale for universal credit is about getting people into the habit of budgeting, and as they would do with a salary, it actually doesn't fit for the people that we are supporting.
I'll take Ms Oldham and then come to Ms Hand.
We also need to take into account that some people are going from weekly payments to monthly, and that's a huge jump kind of overall. We're very much of the thought that there should be equal kind of choice between whether it suits somebody lifestyle and needs and vulnerabilities, whether they have a fortnightly payment or monthly payment, and for those to be equally weighted, so that everything else that we're talking about within certainly social sector is all about being person-centred, and that seems to be one thing that doesn't sit within that. So given the choice and no kind of waiting to one way or the other would be our preference.
Mr. Hewer?
A couple of points on the administrative side. A problem that housing associations are encountering with universal credit is the fact that the assessment date for each claimant can vary from day to day and the payment date. So you have a situation where they have to, if they're going to have a large number of tenants on universal credit, they will be having to know which particular day and the transactions that causes. And the other issue is the discretionary housing payments, which are being used at the moment to mitigate the bedroom tax. Now, discretionary housing payments are paid on a set date, usually on a four-weekly basis. So housing associations, are hit with a double whammy in if they're supporting tenants and engaging with them on the date that their universal credit payment comes in, and then they're having to then approach the tenants again perhaps the next week or 2 weeks later just to engage with them about the discretionary housing payments. It creates a huge administrative problem for them. I think also in terms of the question, the debate about the frequency of payments, we hope one of the things that will come out of the Scotland Bill will be the option for more frequent payments. But there's still the real problem is the initial waiting period, which will still be up to 6 weeks, by which time, particularly for those families that are, if you like, on the financial edge, that's when the damage will be done. Having to cope with the seven-day waiting period where they will have to find the rent from their own resources, added to the assessment period and the administrative period, adding up to, as I said, 6 weeks.
Ms. Campbell, did you want to come in at this point?
Yep. The information that we have from our members reflects a lot of what Jeremy has said just now in terms of the complexity of the situation. As Jeremy pointed out, people can have the anniversary of their claim on any day of the month. If you add to that the option for people to choose fortnightly payments or monthly payments, it's adding another layer of complexity. While this was pointed out by some of our members, they did say, while it would be complex, it would be manageable, but a lot of thought would need to go into the management process, the IT system, and just really being on top of the ball and keeping up with their tenants and really trying to intervene at the earliest possible point if they were getting into trouble with arrears. While saying that, most of our members did feel that tenants should be given the choice. They felt that a lot of their tenants would manage a lot easier with more frequent payments, and that would help them to keep their rent arrears under control. Again, a significant concern for us is the waiting period, and that 6 week lead-in time is going to set people up with arrears from the start. It's going to mean that they're going to struggle even more with difficult financial dilemmas from the very start of their claim. Do they try and pay off their rent arrears? Do they pay for food? Do they pay for bills? It's going to make people who are in a difficult situation already, it's going to increase their stress and the dilemmas for them and for their landlords and how they deal with it.
Okay. I'm going to open it up to Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. At the very early stages of all of this, there was some housing associations where direct payments took place, including Dunedin Canmore here in Edinburgh. And the committee at that point went out to speak to people who were going to go through these changes. And during our visit there, we spoke to a guy who quite freely admitted that he had a major alcohol problem. He'd stayed sober to speak to the committee.
And he was brutally honest about his situation and said basically that if he got that money, he would drink it within a day or two and end up evicted quite quickly, which would obviously cause problems not only for him, but also for the housing provider too. What do you think about this kind of situation where, you know, people with addictions or other problems, whether that be alcohol or drugs or gambling or whatever it may be, may find some real difficulties here and find themselves without a roof over their heads? What have you fed in to the UK government about such situations? Maybe start with Mr. Hewer, convener.
Under the universal credit rules for alternative payment arrangements. Now, those there's two instances really where they're used, and one is where the arrears have accumulated of up to 8 weeks, and therefore all alternative payment arrangements can be set up for the housing association. The other instance is where there are distinct vulnerabilities. As you've described, if somebody has got particular vulnerabilities, and it may be wise to have alternative payment arrangements set up from the start. Now, in theory, that's perfectly possible. The problem is how the decision is made, and I think because the decision lies with the decision maker in the DWP, it's a bureaucratic process, and the decision maker just because of the way it is set up, doesn't know that person personally. What we're hoping for to get from the government is there is some talk about having trusted partner status, where an organisation such as a housing association, who may have direct first-hand intelligence on the particular claimant, can say, this particular tenant needs to have an alternative payment arrangement set up from the start. And the DWP will say, fair enough, we'll accept your decision, without sort of question, subject to review. You know, there will be periodic reviews to see whether that person could then go on to manage their own payments.
Ms. Oldham?
I would echo what Jeremy said about the trusted partner status, that actually that kind of provides quite a good solution, because we certainly have concerns around the knowledge from the decision maker side of things. You can't be somebody who's knowledgeable about every element of addictions, mental health, etc., whereas if there's actual organisations with those expertise, why are we not using those who are actually working side by side with people as well? It seems a bit of a wasted resource not to tap into.
Ms. Campbell?
Yep, I would probably reflect those views again about the organisations who have built up relationships with these people are best placed to decide or decide with them what is best for them payment-wise. The recommendation that we put forward in our written evidence was that where there is a known vulnerability, or where we know that somebody may have difficulty in managing their money, that the payments should go directly to the landlord in those cases. We felt that in all other cases, tenants should be able to make the choice as to whether they want to receive the payments directly or they want them to go to their landlord. Even if they ultimately decide to have the payments made directly to their landlord, they are exercising some choice in the matter and taking response for their finances that way. So again, even in those circumstances, if the tenant decides to have the payments made directly to themselves and then they do fall into trouble, if they do fall into arrears, you would have the alternative payment to fall back on as protection for the landlord.
Ms. Morrison?
I'd agree with that, particularly in terms of mental well-being, where somebody might not have a mental health diagnosis, but there might be other issues like depression that other providers are not aware of, that actually the person providing support, whether that's a third sector organisation or whether it's the housing provider, may be aware of and may be able to share that. I think there might be issues of confidentiality within that and how much the person might want that information being shared with the DWP as well, because I think people's experience of the Job Centre Plus or the DWP may not be experienced as a supportive mechanism for them. It might be seen punitive at times.
Mr. Gunn? Yeah, I think in terms of administration, I think whilst APA is a function to pay direct to landlord, I think a fear I do have certainly is DWP's capacity to actually operate APAs on a substantial basis that we have just now. So I think there would be an IT overhead. But I think of, in terms of financial benefit, not just to the claimant or the customer, but also to the cash flow of the businesses, you know, for future investment, etc., there needs to be that guaranteed income wherever possible, where it's appropriate to do that. But I do fear that whilst the APAs are a function that can actually work just now, I do fear if it was to be rolled out sort of significantly across Highland or across Scotland for that matter, I'm not sure if the current system would actually manage it. And I think it would lead to quite significant delays in some payments.
It leads me to the question whereby you are in the process of rollout. You've already told us that 90% of folk are in arrears already. How many of those folks have had the ability to have direct housing payments to you rather than to themselves as part of their UC?
The AP process had some challenging issues in the first opening year, 18 months. Since February, March, things have settled down and it's certainly much, much better. Over 100 APA requests have been received and administered through it, so that's helped minimise certainly the arrears. About 75% of the APA requests have been accepted. So it's not a given that you'll get the APA accepted. There can be various reasons for it, including there can be a gap between the APA being requested and then, for instance, the tenant then may move property. And if the tenant has moved property, the chances are the APA would get paid to the new landlord rather than the existing landlord of where the arrears is in relation to. Because when APA or payments are made at the end of the month, it's the landlord that you're with at that time that receives that payment, even though it might have been a different landlord in the 2 or 3 weeks leading up to the end of that month.
Huge amount of pitfalls and even trying to get to the point of making sure that if there is an exemption and it's paid directly to the landlord, you've still got complications.
Correct.
There if there is any change in circumstance.
Yep. Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. I want to move on because you touched upon this, Mr. Gunn, and basically this is for Mr. Gunn and Mr. Hewer, convener. We've heard previously about cash flow difficulties that councils and housing associations may face, which, you know, I think puts some real strain on long-term planning and particularly in terms of making decisions about refurbishment or new build. And that would affect, I think, smaller housing associations much more than larger organisations. Could you maybe tell us what difficulties you could possibly foresee if there is a huge build-up of non-payment arrears? Mr. Gunn first.
Yeah, within Highland Council, the current rent arrears figure is just 1.5 million. For the UC cases, Kevin, it's 106,000. In terms of materiality, it's not material just now. So in terms of requiring that money to have capital builds, it's not just now preventing us from building, you know, council properties, etc., because the rollout of UC, the take-up, is still relatively low. Like, for instance, we've got about 1,200 existing UC claimants, whereas you've got about 14,000 housing benefit claimants and 18,000 council tax reduction. So we've been live for nearly 2 years, but the take-up is still low because of the strict criterion. But if you were to extrapolate that over a period of time, if, for instance, the 60% of cases that are non-pensioner did move on to UC, the reality would be is this would be a cash flow problem for the council, for Highland Council. And that would then present problems because you would then ultimately have less capital available to build some of your council properties. It's a financial fact. At the end of the day, we would have less money coming into the organisation and we would need to make decisions to address that.
Complete rollout, you foresee difficulties in terms of new build and refurbishment of existing homes as well?
It would, because the reality is you'd have less income, and like any other business, public or private sector, there's less income coming into the business. So something would have to stop or be reduced, or a combination of both.
Mr. Hewer, please.
I think the point is that about 61% of housing association income is from housing benefit. two-thirds of that would be from working age households. The first effect I think that housing associations would see is in terms of the borrowing, their ability to borrow at competitive rates from lending houses, because I think one of the things that they have found is that when calculating the covenants, that it's based on an assumption of an income stream, and obviously if that income stream is undermined, the banks will come back and want to renegotiate the covenants, and in future borrowing would be more expensive. But the other thing I think is, as you alluded to, the direct payment demonstration projects, which Dunedin and Campbell were involved with, I think their payment rate ultimately was about 94%, as opposed to what they would have expected, which was about 99% with the old system. Now, that may not sound a lot, but that sort of, if you like, that 5% differential could be the difference between actually holding your head above water and going under.
We are not going to have control of this element of social security, but obviously it's going to have a direct impact on the devolved issue of housing and the possibility of expanding the social housing stock. Would that be a fair comment?
I would say, because if you like, universal credit is a reserve power, yeah.
And if this is rolled out across Scotland, then we could see a major impact on our ability to build new social housing.
It could be a factor, but it's hard to say, you know, to look in the future, because it has to be said that the DWP have changed, amended some of their procedures for when they've been found not to work the way that they thought. But, you know, there is that concern that we would, it would adversely affect our ability to build.
Mr. Gunn, would you agree with that?
Yes.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Could I also just mention on the theme of housing, Kevin, the figures I gave was like mainstream as housing is 106,000. Temporary accommodation is much more challenging as well. And whilst we're on the theme of, you know, housing and the cash flow, temporary accommodation is particularly challenging, you know, within Highland. We do have our own 100 owned properties under the HRA, and we've got about 200 in the private sector, as well as a framework for B&B to try and handle homelessness. But there is no doubt that the cash flow for temporary accommodation is even more challenging. You know, for instance, there's only about 10 accounts where there's arrears with temporary accommodation. But that's the average rent arrears for temporary accommodation is about £1,400 an account, whereas for a UC it's only £700 an account. So the issue in housing and social housing is challenging, but there is a link, direct or otherwise, into the provision of temporary accommodation and what each council must do. What I'd also add within Highland is that our weekly charges for temporary accommodation is nothing like as high as, you know, other parts of Scotland for various reasons, such as your Dundees and Central Belts, where temporary accommodation prices is significantly higher per week than we have in Highland.
Okay. Can I bring in Ms. McKelvey?
Thank you very much, Convener. Just to follow on some of the points that my colleague Kevin Stewart has picked up with you, and it's mainly to move it on a wee bit and ask that if in any of the pilot areas, if there's been any study done of the impact on people affected by sanctions, and whether that's then had a knock-on effect for the ability to remain in their home, and then how that obviously impacts on councils who provide housing, but obviously, you know, private landlords and housing associations to provide the right support for that person, but also having to follow the rules as far as, you know, maybe going down the road of eviction. Mr. Hewer.
I would say that a recent submission that we made to the Welfare Reform Committee, I think it was in response to the Right Honourable David Mundell's question mark about the use of food banks, and we found that from the survey that we did of members, from the returns, that the vast majority of food bank referrals that housing associations were aware of was usually down to either benefit delays or benefit sanctions. Now, housing associations are not in the business of wanting to evict people. They will do what they can to maintain the tenancy. And if you like, what is, I think, happening at the moment is that housing associations are bearing the brunt of increased arrears and trying to mitigate it however they can, eventually getting alternative payment arrangements or trying to get them where they come up. But it's very much, as I said, it's the administrative hassle. Even if everything was working absolutely tickety-boo and people were paying their things, the additional administrative burden on housing associations has been quite considerable. And I think the other thing is the unconnectedness of the system, because I was at a recent meeting in Glasgow and I raised the issue about council tax reduction, and there was a concern, and it was admitted that there was a concern that people on whereas before, I think, with housing benefit, because it was done by the same section of the local authority, if they knew that somebody was on housing benefit, it sort of, I don't know the exact administrative things, but it must have sort of lit a light that said, aha, that person needs a council tax reduction as well. With universal credit, and there isn't that connect. And so they were anticipating, I think, they would expected, it was early days, about 200 housing benefit cases for council tax reduction. I think they had 120. Now, eventually those, if like the missing may catch up, but there's always those that don't. I mean, we found with discretionary housing payments, for example, there hasn't been 100% take-up because there's, for one reason or another, despite the best efforts of housing associations to engage with their tenants, some tenants have opted not to take discretionary housing payments. So in answer to your question, I don't think we've seen an increase in evictions, but at the moment, that's because, if you like, the housing associations are taking the strain. Whether they will be able to do that as the years go on, I'm not so sure.
Ms Oldham, can I maybe ask you to think about, because I know that, you know, you specifically at the end when people actually become homeless and you're supporting them either at the start of that process or where they're maybe, you know, quite far forward. I think maybe like you, when people come to me, they're usually at crisis point, and whether you have seen any of that transfer over from people that have been involved in this new system to the type of work that you're having to undertake for people every day.
Well, just to explain, we're the national membership organisation, so everybody sort of feeds into us rather than being frontline. But certainly, one of the issues seems to be where the system wasn't working properly to start with, and so people, the housing element of the benefits, where somebody was being sanctioned, wasn't kind of actually still taking place. Now that that's clear that the housing element should still be being paid, there's less of an issue. But the fact that it's gone on for so long with it not being paid, we're at that kind of strange situation where there's a bit of an urban myth going around where not everybody is of the understanding about what their rights and things are, and so if the housing element isn't being paid, there's still somebody of the belief that actually that's what should be happening. So it's more around that we've heard and seen of the issues. But certainly, yes, sanctions is a huge issue overall. Out with even just the kind of housing side of things, as Jeremy said, food banks and people actually needing to kind of use every resource round about them is huge. It's a major issue, which then has a knock-on effect to people's mental health, criminal kind of. If you've not got food and the only way you can actually feed your children is to go shoplifting, the reality is that's what you're going to do, etc. So, it's more the knock-on effects from that that's huge.
Yeah. I spent a wee bit of time at the Hamilton District Food Bank on Saturday packing some bags for people and having some conversations, and you find out the reasons why people actually end up there are just horrifying, that people get to that stage. Has any other panel got something to say about sanctions, Mr Gunn?
do you, similar to Jeremy at Highland in terms of evictions, there's nothing to suggest at all increase in evictions because of sanctions. I mean, on the contrary, we'd be looking to use Scottish Welfare Fund discretionary housing payments, you know, to mitigate that financial impact on the tenants or the claimants. I think this is also about, for me, about availability of information. For instance, for sanctions per job centre for each of the six in Highland, I can per month see how many have been sanctioned within each job centre for GSA. And it's ranging between 3 to 5%. For love nor money, can I see data for sanctions referring to universal credit? That data is not made available. So you can draw your own conclusions for that in terms of that data. But I think this is about an openness that we need. Because at the end of the day, whether it's the customer being served by the DWP or customer being served by the Scottish Government or by local authorities, it's the same one customer at the end of the day. And we need to have the most joined-up approach for their benefit. And part of that is about transparency, about information, and how well we're actually delivering these services.
Yeah, I think most of my concerns have been covered. I think, you know, part of the significant issue here is that obviously sanctions and conditionality are being reserved to the UK government, which limits what the Scottish government can do around that. And there obviously also remains eligibility criteria around discretionary housing payments and what they can be used for. I think that there remains issues around the payment of DHP to people who have been sanctioned and the fact that a DHP cannot be awarded to directly mitigate a sanction. So again, we're limited in how we can help these people. Obviously, there is indirect support and there's voluntary support. There are food banks, but those are not the best ways to ensure that people get the help that they need.
Ms. Morrison.
We do deliver frontline homelessness services to young people, and doing this a brief consultation with the young people, 38% of the young people in our Glasgow homelessness services had experienced a sanction, and the use of sanctions, 38%. And if you think about it, if it's young people that have experienced trauma, that have got the additional vulnerabilities in terms of substance use, mental well-being, and have maybe also been through the care system, if they're late for an appointment or if they forget something, and a lot of the sort of cognitive functioning is affected by trauma in terms of memory. So a lot of these young people are experiencing a high rate of sanctions, and a lot of our services now have got links with food banks where our services are distributing the food vouchers. And I think, in line with the other people, it's not maybe necessarily a rise in homelessness at this moment in time, but I think it is a rise and probably an additional strain on the use of food banks.
Yeah, just that sort of leads me in quite nicely to my second part of my question, Convener, if you'll indulge me. And it's about the impact of people with any illness, and you're talking about, you know, young people that have faced trauma, that maybe have, you know, some trauma-related illness it's attached to that, whether it's physical or it's a mental health issue, but also maybe people who have got a progressive disability who have been receiving benefits that's allowed them to stay in work, like DLA and PIP and stuff like that, but their illness has got progressive, therefore they've had to move out of the workplace and onto other sort of a support benefits, and also people who have been determined as terminally ill. Right now we've got a system, it's not perfect, and I know that, and I know absolutely that it's not perfect, and I think the Child Poverty Action Group actually described the disability element of all of this as incoherent, which is a word that most of you have used this morning, that it's piecemeal, that it's not joined up, and that it actually creates more problems than it fixes. I'm wondering what your experience is and whether any work has been done to mitigate that impact on people, because when you've got somebody moving from one part of the system into another part of the system, that seems to be a real vulnerability, that transition period. And if you've got, you know, either a progressive illness or a terminal illness or something that's not going to get better, how much more difficult that is. I'm really hoping, you know, I can tease some of the, you know, the issues that you've faced, but also maybe some of the ways you've got to resolve that. Because ultimately, what we're looking at here is a social security system for Scotland, you know. And if we don't identify the problems and we don't learn lessons from some of the resolutions that you in the front line have put in place, then we can't create the system that we want to see. So I'm hoping you're going to help me with all of that. Mr. Gunn.
Yeah, thank you. I think in terms of UC, unlike GSA, where there was an implicit consent for benefit advisors to speak direct to DWP about, you know, customers. Under UC, that data sharing is not yet live. It's data sharing is progressing. Jeremy and others may have views in terms of the data sharing to social landlords, but certainly to support service providers for people on UC or coming off UC or other benefits, that sharing is more limited. So it tends to be that we find out things rather than being advised of these changes. I think for me that's one of the key things for certain local authorities and housing associations to do is to have a support framework in place, whether it's through money advice, Assistance Advice Bureau and various other sort of voluntary organisations within Highland, for instance, very much an in-house team as well, supported by CAB and other third sector. And we spend upwards of £1.8 million a year on costs to try and support these very individuals. We've also got housing management officers that are aware of tenants and try to get to know at a local level tenants' circumstances changing. Now, they won't know everything, but if they can have some kind of idea of movement, say from work to out of work, then the sooner you catch that and speak to the tenants, the better. Because it just takes a few weeks and arrears get to a stage that they just can't dig themselves out of that hole. So timing is everything, but as is the support framework. And reality is that does cost a bit of money, an investment. But at the end of the day, if that helps minimise arrears and helps then, again, the early comment speaking to Kevin about in terms of increasing the income and capital funding, there's definitely direct benefits at the end of the day.
Ms Oldham?
Well, we've certainly been trying to work closely with the job centres and the DWP to improve knowledge of what homelessness is and vulnerabilities, because it goes back to what I said about the decision makers. They're kind of expected to be this font of all knowledge, that an expert of everything, when you couldn't be. It's just not possible. And that's the same with the personal advisers, to an even greater extent, really, because they're the first person somebody meets with. So we're trying to play a part to improve their knowledge. But in addition to that, we'd like to see there being a bit more of a dialogue between, for instance, somebody that's working with Quarriers. The person they're working with has heard that they're going to receive a sanction. Well, surely a call from the support worker that they're working with to say, actually, do we know X, Y, and Z? And that can be stopped at that point rather than administration being wasted, etc. Then
we'll get, because some people don't get any notice, they just go to the bank and there's no money.
Absolutely, yeah. Yes, that's the other kind of flaw in the, one of the other flaws in the plan. But we'd certainly like to see a lot more communication, in particular where there's support organisations in place and there's a lot of people with some sort of support framework. So again, it's back to there being use of the organisations who do have the expertise. It's a real wasted resource, and why there's not that dialogue happening more. We'd like to see that happen.
Yeah.
I'd say there have been some positive initiatives. I mean, in the Highland, for example, the job centre will now allow a support worker to accompany a claimant when having the interview. Now, that's obviously got benefits because certainly in terms of the claimant commitment, perhaps a more reasonable, a more rational claimant commitment can be created. Against that, though, there is concerns, particularly on things like the work capability assessment and PIP assessments, that the system has not been set up, is not working as well as it should. I mean, you mentioned claimants who may have a degenerative condition, you know, but they still have to go through the same thing. And the fact that they have to go through a reassessment is quite, it creates anxiety in them. It doesn't help them in the least. And I think also in terms of perhaps understanding of mental health issues in the assessment process is not what it should be. And quite often appointments are missed because of the mental health, the actual idea of going to you know, missing an interview is not really a sort of willful act of neglect. It's part of their condition that means that they don't. Housing associations have obviously invested in support work and they try to intervene where they can. For example, Dunedin Canmore had a case recently where somebody in Edinburgh was invited to go for a PIP assessment in North Berwick. And they said, no, you know, we want to have a PIP assessment, you know, close to that person because of their disability. And the assessment process, I mean, we've long argued that you really need to do an assessment based on the day-to-day abilities of the person and not do it in an isolated instance. And you hear sort of whether they're apocryphal stories or not, isolated ones of... the assessors sort of observing people from a distance with binoculars to see whether they're really disabled or not as they come towards their assessment. Other issues, you know, there are systems issues which there always will be. I mean, somebody in Link Housing Association told us that assessments that were available in Stirling that were provided by Solus were not on the ATOS computer system, therefore they weren't being offered to people living in that area. But those things can be overcome. But I mean, I think there needs to be, and there's been lots of submissions both to this committee and other committees about the need for perhaps a more thought through way of assessing people who have either illness or disability.
Thank you. Ms. Morrison.
In reference to transitions as well, I think it might be worthwhile bearing in mind children with disabilities transitioning to adult services, so the additional impact of the sort of SDS stuff, but also for families, when you've got a child that's moving into adult services, benefits can play a big role within that, and it can be incredibly daunting, even with the supports that the child gets. And I'm still saying child because there can be people at 16, 17 having to go into this adult world, and I think that probably needs some thought. I don't know the answers to it.
Thank you.
Thank you. I've got Mr. Johnson waiting to come in, but John, did you want a quick supplementary or do you want to come in general after Alec?
If I could have a supplementary, actually, it was actually the point that Ashley Campbell made about the discretionary housing payments, which we're supposed to be getting power over, but as you quite correctly pointed out, that we're not actually allowed to use them if someone's been sanctioned and lost their housing benefit, except in exceptional circumstances. This has obviously been the subject of quite a lot of debate in the House of Commons in terms of the Scotland Bill going through Parliament, and I know that both Labour and the SNP tabled amendments asking for that to be looked at again so that you could pay discretionary housing payments to someone even if they had lost their entitlement to housing benefits. Up until now, those amendments haven't been accepted. I just wondered what your view on that was.
It's something that we've raised concerns about before, obviously. The limitations around discretionary housing payments, our members have asked that it could be more flexible, that the Scottish Government obviously explores every possibility for that. But currently, under the wording of the Scotland Bill, you're limited. With regards to sanctions and mitigating sanctions, I've always found that there's a bit of a conflict there. Even in terms of elements of support for people trying to get back into work, which are being devolved to the Scottish Government, but sanctions and conditionality remain reserved. So that sets us up with a system where maybe the Scottish Government would like to take a more supportive or proactive role in trying to help people get back into work, a more sort of carrot-driven method of helping people back into work, but the UK government still holds the stick of sanctions. And so how do we really create a social security system that supports people when we still have that looming over our heads?
Did you want to?
I want to say that the SFHA will reserve judgment until it sees what comes out in the third reading of the Scotland Bill. But what I would say about discretionary housing payments are main criticism is that it's an expedient. It was always seen as a temporary measure, and it is not right to actually use in the long term discretionary housing payments for mitigation of the bedroom tax, particularly when we're going to be faced with an upsurge in the number of people that are affected by the benefit cap, with a reduction of the benefit cap from 26,000 to 20,000. And you're going to see a lot more families, I suspect, even those in standard housing association accommodation may be affected by the bedroom cap. And you may want to, obviously, discretionary housing payments are there to sort of, if you like, ease the transition.
Yeah, I think so. There's various things in discretionary housing payments. I think, personally speaking, I think that they're perhaps addressing the effect rather than the cause. In a perfect system, the amount of DHPs needed should be less than what they are, because the system should be fundamentally correct in the first place, in my take. I think there's an administrative overhead to discretionary housing payments. For instance, Scottish authorities get about £1.5 million a year to process DHPs to fully mitigate the bedroom tax. Well, if you just stop the 14 or 25% penalty for bedroom tax at source, you wouldn't need that 1.5 administration overhead, as well as the delays, etc. And also, you'd guarantee 100% take-up and full mitigation of it. So there's an administrative overhead to DHPs, but also people have to claim them. And the reality is, certainly some of the more vulnerable clients tend not to claim everything they're entitled, either because of ignorance or just because of their lifestyles. Last but by no means least, you have to generally, your earlier comment about, you know, you have to qualify for a housing benefit, for instance, to actually qualify for a DHP. Well, there are some cases in Highland, even we had 3 or 4 cases in June this year, where the claimants and partners are on income support, but their son or daughter has started work and are getting about £12,000 a year gross. As a result, because of the non-debt deduction, they qualify for no housing benefit, and therefore they qualify for no discretionary housing payment. But the claimant and partner circumstances are exactly the same. They haven't changed. It's the other people in the household. So there are a lot of pitfalls to discretionary housing payments. I think they're invaluable as a means to an end to address some of the issues in the system. But I think as part of reviewing any social security system, there should be a less reliance on DHPs, as Jeremy was saying, and actually getting the system right in the first place.
More should have been devolved to Scotland so that we don't have to have this kerfuffle about DHPs.
That would be helpful.
Yes, Ms. Oldham.
We also have a big concern over the actual purpose of DHP now being lost, with 7% being used for what it kind of used to be used for. One of the big things within homelessness was two homes payment. So this is where somebody heard that they were offered a tenancy and were maybe moving from temporary or supported accommodation. So these monies were provided to enable the tenancy that they were moving into to be paid for, and them not to have to just do that from one day to the next. Because I think it's totally unrealistic to have somebody to move from a tenancy, as they're having to do now, and sort out electricity, furniture, everything you have to do to move house within a day, possibly 2 days, but really not any more than that, because even the 2 weeks is quite a short length of time, but that was able to happen with the two homes payments, and things like that have been lost completely. And will be having an impact on tenancy sustainment, because if you've not got the time to actually start out and get your tenancy right from point one, then you're much more likely to fail further down the line. And the money spent on that would have been very small in the kind of scheme of things, but the impact huge. But most councils, from our understanding, have actually chosen for that to be one of the areas that they're not using DHP for. So that's a huge concern to us. Imagine moving house in a day.
Miss Campbell, and then we'll come to Mr. Johnson.
Just to add that we would echo a lot of those points as well. Discretionary housing payments were never meant to be used to mitigate long-term issues like the bedroom tax. In our written submission, we did suggest that with the powers over the variation of the housing element within universal credit, if the Scottish Government decides to mitigate the bedroom tax long-term, that would be a far better way to do it. People don't have to apply for a different benefit. There are no breaks in the claim as such. And it does leave what's left in the discretionary housing payment pot for those other uses. It's more transparent that way. We recognise that the money that was put into the DHP pot to deal with bedroom tax would be taken out, but at least what's left there is then for the original purpose, and it is a lot more clear what DHP would be used for.
Mr. Johnson.
Thank you. Now, it's interesting to note on that issue that David Mundell made it very clear some time ago that he thought that DHP was not the only option to deal with mitigation of an under-occupancy charge, and perhaps not the best option. And I think he's been proved correct with the situation we find ourselves in. However, the issue I wanted to raise actually takes us back to one of the basics about funding and of housing. And that is that over many years now, we've seen the bulk of government contribution towards housing costs move away from bricks and mortar and into the support of costs for individual housing itself. And we've become very reliant on housing benefit as the key foundation of that. And we've heard how it supports the cash flow of large landlords, and it also supports capital investment to a significant extent as well. Now, I'm sure that's not your preferred option for funding the construction of houses, but do you think it's been a good or a bad thing that we've moved away from funding the construction of houses to simply funding housing costs themselves on a large scale?
I think there's been a very interesting report by Shelter that came out that mapped, as you said, perhaps in the 70s, where the proportion of money into subsidising the construction of houses and the support for rent maintenance, the proportions have changed over the years. And I think ideally we would obviously like to see more investment in housing. How you actually, if you like, reverse that trend is going to be quite complex. I think the point to make out is that, if you like, the subsidy that housing associations get to build housing at the moment comes from the Scottish Government. The subsidy that housing associations get for rent maintenance comes from the Westminster Government. Therefore, Westminster, despite housing being, if you like, a devolved matter, there is a degree of control over housing from Westminster. And when we see proposals such as the removal of automatic entitlement of housing benefit for those under 22, where we see the change to the housing benefit, the benefit cap, where we see other aspects, including like the local housing allowance. Now, I mean, obviously, housing is a very, very difficult issue, because in the sense that whereas you're trying to, if you like, having a UK-wide policy on income maintenance, and if like trying to have a level playing field, which is what the benefit system gives at least until very recently, gives across the UK. But then you have housing costs, which have a huge variation across the UK and a huge variation across Scotland as well. It's a hard job. I mean, it's the whole subject of a debate, which is probably not suitable for here, but, you know, issues such as rent control, the effect of right to buy, all those issues are going to affect the ability of housing associations to provide housing.
But during the course of the current government, we've seen significant downward pressure on the amount of money the Scottish Government has put towards the construction of social housing. And you've become progressively more reliant on that income stream that's coming through housing benefit from Westminster. So over the last four and a bit years, we've seen that balance skewed still further. Would that be the case?
I wouldn't say so, because, I mean, if you compare the rise in housing association rents compared to the private sector landlord, I think you would find that housing association rents have broadly maintained a fairly steady trajectory along the lines of inflation, whereas I think private sector rents have gone, are being considerably more than the rate of inflation.
You did see the HAG grant severely depressed for a number of years. You did see the HAG grant, the housing association grant, significantly depressed for a number of years. That was a significant downward pressure on the money available for construction. Surely that made you more reliant on the flow of income from housing benefit to support capital investment.
Housing benefit doesn't support capital investment.
Clare, that you need a steady flow of housing benefit in order to support your ongoing capital investment.
In the sense that we need an income stream in order to pay our debts.
Indeed, yes. I'm simply suggesting that you've become reliant on that income stream for a lot of things that were once supported by other means through government.
No, I don't think that's quite the case.
Mm-hmm. Do you think it's ironic that we have a government in Scotland that's pushing very hard to maximise the use of that income stream that's coming from the DWP and from Westminster, when there is an opposite pressure south of the border which could result in us becoming disproportionately reliant in Scotland on a source of funding that comes from outside Scotland?
I don't think I'm qualified to comment on what may be happening south of the border.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bibby?
A kind of question on a similar theme, but just kind of obviously without prejudice, rents are going up for people. It's a huge factor in people's monthly outgoings. What is being done, or what more could be done, to reduce the rental increases that people are seeing? Because clearly that does have a knock-on impact in terms of the level of money required for housing benefit. And you mentioned that housing associations had put up rents less than private sector. I wonder if you could tell us a wee bit, if you've got any more figures about to hand about rental increases in the housing association. Perhaps Highland Council could tell us, you know, as well, the level of rents in Highland and the increases there.
I haven't got figures immediately to hand, but I'd be more than happy to provide them to the committee if that's what they would like. I think anything that increases the administrative burden on housing associations is obviously going to have a knock-on effect on all rents. And again, with universal credit, for example, whereas before with the housing benefit, there was usually a transfer every 4 weeks or so from the local authority in terms of the housing benefit payments to the association. So in terms of if only bank transaction charges, that was a fairly cheap way of actually accruing the money. If you've then got hundreds of tenants each making individual payments, you're going to have the transaction charges that your bank levies on each of those individual payments. But also you're going to have the challenge of ensuring that, if you like, your rent accounts are reconciled. And that's one of the other issues to do with universal credit and discretionary housing payments, is that universal credit is paid on a monthly basis. Discretionary housing payments are paid on a four-weekly basis. So you've got to actually find out whether you've got your exact amount of money in. The other thing I would say, which I haven't mentioned, which is of very much a concern to housing associations, is the changes in the rules about eligibility of housing costs under universal credit compared to housing benefit. In particular, the service charges for adaptations for people with disabilities, things like automatic door closers, track and hoist systems, closemat toilets and things like that. Those maintenance charges are eligible under housing benefit rules. They're not going to be eligible under universal credit housing cost rules. And, you know, from a personal point of view, I don't see, you know, that seems to be self-defeating, because, if you like, for a disabled tenant, a track and hoist system is as essential as a gas central heating system is for any other tenant. And yet, you know, the maintenance charges for the gas central heating system, nobody sort of says that, is questioning whether that is an eligible service charge or not. And it's self-defeating, because if housing associations aren't providing adapted housing, what's the alternative? Care home? Hospital? Are those any cheaper? Is that a better use of public money? I don't think so.
Councillor Gunn, very Yes, good.
I don't have the specific rent figures for the current year. What I do know, but looking ahead, what I would say is that obviously the local housing allowance rates are going to be frozen or minimised to 1% over the next 3 to 4 years. So that in itself is a controlling mechanism on the amount of housing benefit, you know, that can get paid. In terms of actually in the early comment about construction, obviously within the local authorities, it's slightly different to housing associations where we've got a ring-fenced housing revenue account, obviously which the rental income provides a sizeable source of that income. But what councils can also do is, you know, utilise other powers that we've already got, such as through council tax, you know, through the additional discounts, which we've done, created like things like land banking funds, etc. But also from April, like similar to some other councils, we've introduced the charge for council tax for long-term empties up to 200%, and using that income to try and fund some of these one-off or these much-needed, you know, constructions. I think reality is the rental market is very different across all of Scotland. The pressures in Highland are very different to Glasgow or Edinburgh, and that's reflected in rent, but it's reflected in collection rates, etc. But there are some things available, albeit limited, that councils can do and looking to do, you know, through, as I say, you know, the council tax, as a for instance. But the earlier comment, certainly within the HRA, is obviously housing benefit is an important cash flow, but it's also important cash flow for the tenants to help them pay their rent. And that's what we shouldn't lose sight of here at the end of the day. It's trying to support the tenants who are ultimately our customers at the end of the day.
I'm just finally going to bring in Mr. Stewart just to finish off.
It's a slightly different topic, convener, because we've concentrated very much on the housing element, but other parts of submissions have other things in them. And it's the Quarrier submission that I'm looking at in particular, where you state the reality, however, is that people with a disability have been subject to a disproportionate amount of cuts in their benefits, which is undermining their human rights and preventing them from participating fully in society. How is the UK government's current social security system breaching people's human rights, Ms. Morrison?
To be honest with you, I'm from the children and family section. I don't work directly with the disabilities, so I don't feel as if I've got the knowledge to comment upon that. I can speak to our policy officer and ask him to get back to you about that.
I think that would be extremely useful because a lot of folk are saying that they feel that folks' human rights are being breached, and I don't disagree with that, I have to say, in a lot of cases. And it would be very interesting for us as a committee to have examples of where organisations think that folks' human rights are at risk because of these social security changes. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I've had another couple of the members indicate they want to come in, so I'll go to Ms. McGilvey first.
Thanks. Very much. Can we have a really, really quick supplementary? But I also chair the European and External Relations Committee, and we've just launched a call for evidence on the impact in Scotland of a repeal of the Human Rights Act. So if you've got anything that can help us in our deliberations, that would be extremely helpful. Sorry for the plug, convener. But very, very quickly, my supplementary is on the very mischievous question from my colleague, Mr. Johnson, there on capital budgets and the impact of capital budgets. And it was really just to clear up whether it's council, because I understand the difference between housing association grant and how council maybe use different methods of raising funds for capital investment. And if over the past few years you have seen the fact that the disproportionate impact on capital budgets, the cuts to capital budgets from subsequent, whether it was a coalition government or the new majority government at Westminster, has a direct impact on your ability to build houses.
Within Highland, in terms of capital, would say the answer would be no, just not, but the potential is mostly if UC was rolled out in its current format, the impact on cash flow would be material. It's more the potential rather than the actual to date, and okay. it would be my take on it.
Mr.
Hewer? Sorry, you couldn't repeat the question.
It was mainly the fact that over the past few years, the Scottish Government's been hit by up to, in some cases, 38% cuts in their capital budgets, you know, and whether that's what's had the impact on the ability for housing associations and other organisations to actually build homes.
I think, obviously, you know, that did have an effect. I think that a few years ago, when the HAG allowances were reduced, and it was found that a lot of housing associations actually sort of curtailed their development programmes. Those HAG figures have been revised now, so that we're seeing a pick-up in new build from housing associations, which is very welcome. And we're also, the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations is pioneering a financing scheme for smaller associations to club together in order to be able to build. So, you know, we will try, obviously, our best, and associations will are fairly adroit at sort of if there's an opening or a gap which will enable them to build, I'm sure that they will.
Thank you.
Okay.
Ms.
McCampaign. There's another 500 million
covenant
that was announced yesterday. I should build a few houses.
Ms.
McCampaign, please. Yeah, something I wanted to ask earlier. From April 2017, those out of work aged 18 to 21 making new claims under Universal Credit won't get the housing element of Universal Credit. And obviously that's not something that we can mitigate because the powers are not being devolved to us. And I wondered if that was concerns you had about that and whether you had made any planning for it?
Lauren, I know that the Scottish Government is coordinating negotiations with the DWP about the exceptions to the rule on the exceptions to the 18 to 21 year old. And obviously that's not quite the case in Scotland because tenancies occasionally are given to 16-year-olds as well. So we're trying to protect those who are certainly the most vulnerable to make them exempt in such as, you know, those that are coming out of care, for example, those with children or expecting expecting a child to be exempt from that where there's been an irretrievable breakdown. But it is a very, very complex area, and in fact the list of exceptions is that are being proposed are quite comprehensive. And I suppose the cynic might say, well, who's left? Who's going to be hit with the charge? But we'll have to see. I think, but the concern is, and it's been raised before, about discretionary housing payments. You can only have discretionary housing payments if you have an entitlement to housing benefit. So those under 22 who are hit by, who do not have entitlement to housing benefit won't have entitlement to discretionary housing payment. And, you know, I think that if you like, I think it's known in policy circles as the nudge philosophy. And I think the idea is to nudge those to go back and live with their parents. Now, whether that's a practical proposition remains to be seen. And I think there are going to be some people that are going to be hurt.
Ms. Oldham.
Mm-hmm. I echo a lot of what Jeremy said there, but really just to really push the 16 and 17-year-olds being a real concern area, and it seems to be something that seems to have kind of missed a lot of attention. There we're really, really talking the extreme, most vulnerable cases. Not huge numbers, but you know, we've got to get that right for 16, 17-year-olds. And probably more than one answer as well, whether they're chosen to be kind of looked at through the same system as sort of through care or a whole new system or a whole new kind of exemptions that suit them for within Scotland, but not one answer for everyone, I would suggest.
Thank you. Can I finally, just before we close, just ask a question? I think it's probably relevant to Mr. Gunn more than anyone, but if anyone else wants to contribute, please indicate to me. And it's to do with some of the evidence we took with our visit to Highland Council as well. And it's this idea of the scalability of the manual interventions involved and the issue of the data sharing in particular, because we also took evidence to find out that support couldn't be given to people directly from front desks because they didn't have access to the universal credit elements of people's claims. So even for claimants, it was very, very difficult because they couldn't get that front desk support anymore. If these issues aren't resolved, can you give an indication of what you think the impact would be on rolling out universal credit without fixing these issues?
In terms of financial impact, Claire, I mean, I wouldn't like to put a figure on that, you know, across Scotland. I think as a model, the work coaches in DWP and Highland, I have to give credit to them. They're very good individuals, very dedicated to what they do. That there's absolutely no doubt. But when a customer comes in and they've got, they're trying to get a job, but they've also got universal credit, work coaches quite often don't have access to the universal credit screen. So they can't answer the question even if they needed to. So they're having to speak to the service centre, you know, for that. We've certainly taken the steps of having, you know, our own staff working closely with DWP in the same offices, you know, so we can catch, you know, these customers and help them, you know, at the end of the day in terms of that various support model. I think also from that point of view is that we're more expert on financial advice, whereas DWP's main drive is obviously employability. So we're coming at speaking to the same customer but from different perspectives, and we're trying to join them up the best we can. Without that, the reality is, you know, benefits could go unclaimed, changes could go unreported, and also then that would impact again on the entitlement and take up or lack of, you know, across Highland and, you know, across Scotland. But to actually put a figure on it, I wouldn't like to say. But the reality would be is, if universal credit is not being claimed by those entitled to it, the chances are they won't be able to pay their council tax or their other bills at the end of the day.
Okay. Very, very quick supplementary, Mr. Johnson.
Hope so. It's a different subject entirely and we can keep this short. After a sticky start, councils did extremely well at administering the welfare fund. If we're going forward with the prospect of developing new benefits in new areas that are devolved, do you see councils as being a suitable level at which other benefits could be administered?
Very quick answers, please.
Yes, I think services delivered at a local level is absolutely a must. I think the reality, a mixture of some stuff delivered at a national level and some stuff delivered at a local level, I think generally may be, you know, the best outcome. But without doing a much more detailed options appraisal, I couldn't say one or t'other. I think, though, that local authorities... We administer EMA on behalf of the Scottish Government and generally do that because we work into a set of rules.
Costs were worryingly high with what's been devolved so far as a proportion of the total. If you had more, a greater range of responsibilities, would that give us an opportunity to push down administrative costs within the council?
Yes, it would. And with respect, what I would also say within Highland Council, what we have done is we've actually co-located and actually made generic our Scottish Welfare Fund team with our housing benefit team, with our council tax reduction team. So you already get the economies of scale. So I would challenge whether or not it is actually costing certainly Highland in relation to a lot of money to process Scottish Welfare Fund, because in my view it's not. But what we are doing is crisis grants are paid 100% within a day and community care grants 100% within 3 days. So I would challenge, I think we're actually delivering quite an efficient service, and certainly the performance metrics would suggest, similar to EMA, we're actually making quite a good job of it. So I think the potential is there for local authority to do more.
Thank you very much, convener.
Final word, Mr. Hewer, very quickly.
Just on the question of scalability, I would commend to the committee the report of the Public Accounts Committee in the last Parliament that expressed a number of concerns about both the live system and the digital system. I'd also point out that obviously come April next year, we're going to have very, very many more people on universal credit, and one of the issues is the adjustment of housing costs with rent reviews that usually happen in April. That's going to be, we've been advised by the DWP, the bulk data sharing has had to be put set aside, and that is going to be so obviously there's going to be a manual process, and I think that will be a considerable headache for all concerned.
Appreciate that. Thank you very much. Can I thank you all for your participation this morning? I'm going to suspend for 5 minutes and allow the panels to swap over. Thank you.
Thanks for your indulgence.
Welcome back. Can I welcome to committee to give evidence today Mark Ballard, Head of Policy of Barnardo Scotland, Maggie Kelly, Consultant Policy Advisor of One Parent Families Scotland, John Dickie, Director of Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland, Keith Dryburgh, Policy Manager, Citizens Advice Scotland, Peter Kelly, Director of the Poverty Alliance, and Alison McLaughlin, Money Advisor, Children First. You're very welcome to committee this morning. And can I open up questions to committee members? Any opening gambits? Well, we just had a discussion about, obviously, the focus today is on universal credit and impact. So the opening gambit to the last panel was about the change to monthly payments and just generally what the implications of that could be in terms of delivery of service. So, yeah, Keith Dryburgh, thank you.
Thank you. The committee may be aware that Citizens Advice Scotland undertook a survey of 600 benefit claimants at the start of August to ask them how they currently budget and how they might be affected by the terms of universal credit. So we asked them how they currently budget, and about 26% said weekly, 22% said fortnightly, and 24% said monthly. So there's a very widespread of how people budget. And most people plan that way because that's when their money comes in. We found that about a third of claimants were already struggling to make it to the next payments and having to borrow money or get a crisis grant. And we asked them how would they cope with a monthly payment, and almost half of those who are currently claiming benefits that will become universal credit indicated that they would struggle to reach the end of the month and were worried about the implications of that, though it's worth saying a fifth said that they'd have no problem with that. So there was this about 45% of benefit claimants that said they would struggle with a monthly payment.
Okay, is there anyone else? Want to Mr. Dickie?
Yeah. It's not just to add to what Keith's saying. We're certainly getting evidence from families that we spoke to using Food Bank, where even two weekly payments were causing problems, and that even budgeting over a 2-week period was on a very low income was a key issue for them in terms of then ending up having to use a food bank. So the new powers over the payment of universal credit, I think we're very much keen to see those used to give claimants choice and give them the option of a greater frequency of payment and move to a choice of at least a 2-week payment. I mean, one of the things we flagged up in our evidence was that does raise an issue, given that the monthly waiting period before universal credit payment is made remains reserved. So you would potentially find yourself in a situation where you have to wait a month, it's paid a month in arrears, you wait that month and then you only get a 2-week payment. So I think it would need to be accompanied by a commitment to give choice for more frequent payments. Would need to be accompanied by looking at the use of discretionary payments and the powers to make discretionary payments to top up that, or to make a discretionary payment to ensure that for that first payment they get enough to cover the month.
Ms. Kelly, yeah.
Thank you. Really, just to echo some of the previous comments, quite a number of our clients have raised serious concerns about being able to budget if they're going to be having automatic monthly payments. Although, as Keith has pointed out, some people have said that they would prefer that, but I think probably the broader concern has been that it will cause serious problems. And I suppose the what we would like to see is basically more choice for loan parents to actually be able to decide when their payments are going to be made. If a monthly payment would suit them better, then they should be able to claim that way. And if not, maybe a 2-weekly payment would be more suitable for them. I think the main thing to remember about this is, I mean, people kind of think, well, you know, surely it's just a few weeks. The amount of money that people are struggling to live on is so tiny that there is really a need to have shorter periods for people, and I think that's the key thing to remember about it. And I also think this issue about the waiting period for universal credit is something we need to consider, and as John said, maybe look at having some sort of a policy or agreement about some sort of discretionary payments if you have a shorter period and you're going to have to wait for over a month for your first payment.
Okay, Mr. Kelly.
Just very briefly to follow up on what the others have said, we'll be publishing some work later this month looking at the impact of welfare reform in Glasgow, and some of that work has been engaging with advisers, and the advisers certainly have echoed the concerns that we've just heard about moving to 4 weekly payments or monthly payments. I think one of the other things to say is that I think why some of the rationale for moving to this kind of approach is to mirror what we think goes on in the labour market, and the fact that most people get paid on a four-weekly basis or a monthly basis. I think we need to remember that for a fairly significant minority of people, they're still paid fortnightly or in some cases weekly, and particularly people who are on who are in lower paid work. So that sense of we're moving towards a system that's widely understood and that people are able to budget that way generally, I don't think necessarily holds true, and particularly when people are moving in and out of work, which, as we know, at the lower end of the labour market is often the case.
Okay. I'm going to miss Mr. Ballard, and I'll come back to you.
Thank you. I'd like to very much echo the remarks that have been made earlier, but also from a Barnardo's point of view, highlight the fact that through the Children and Young People Scotland Act, we've developed a new architecture for supporting vulnerable families, families with a particular need, and the very positive emphasis in that act was bringing all the agencies that are working with a vulnerable family together so that we can make sure we get the maximum benefit by integrating what the local authority is doing to support a family, where health is supporting a family, where schools or other agencies are supporting a family. And the concern we hear a lot from our staff is that the missing element of that jigsaw is the welfare system. And that actually the thing that is pushing some of those families that Keith talked about into crisis could be a shift from fortnightly payments to monthly payments. And the difficulty of budgeting then has an impact on the ability of all those other services to effectively support a family. Because it's very difficult to support a family when you're trying to deal with an issue about a child's behaviour at school if it actually roots back into the fact that the family is struggling to budget, and that poor behaviour at school comes at the end of every month, and you know why that is. It's because the family are potentially struggling with budget issues. So in terms of the wider conversation about what future opportunities look like, the ability to have a better relationship between that new architecture for supporting families and any future welfare system. So the conversation that Maggie Kelly talked about in terms of flexibility can happen so that those discretionary payments, those shifts in potentially from monthly payments to fortnightly or even weekly payments can be informed by other conversations that are happening about effectively supporting vulnerable families or families in crisis, I think will be really important.
Mr. Dryburgh, you want to back in?
I just wanted to quickly add another question in the survey we asked. We asked claimants when they would prefer to receive payments. We asked them whether weekly, fortnightly or monthly. 55% said weekly, 32% said fortnightly, and 13% said monthly. I don't think that means that we shouldn't go with monthly. I think it says that maybe we should give people the choice. Another finding we had is that people who had control and choice over their budgets actually tend to budget better. So I think if you give people the choice of when they get paid, that actually will improve their ability to make their budget last.
Thank you. I'm Ms. McLaughlin here.
We would certainly agree with that. Our experience in working with families is they are very adept at managing their budgets. In terms of receiving benefits at the moment, what families tend to do is to stagger them so that they can manage their money better. So child benefit, for instance, may be paid weekly, income support fortnightly, child tax credits four-weekly. Therefore, they know when I'm going to get a big pay or when I've got a longer week because I've got less money. And our concern is that with the changeover, there will be a delay in those benefits being paid. And as was mentioned, difficulties in accessing crisis payments.
I Just before I open up to committee, Mr. Ballard, you talked about the disconnect between what the Scottish Government has tried to do in terms of the Children and Young People's Bill for families. But we just heard in the previous evidence session about a discussion about the housing element support being taken away from 18 to 21-year-olds. But, of course, in Scotland, we do have tenancies for 16-year-olds and onwards. So in terms of all the work that was done in supporting care leavers and the work that was done to ensure that they had support services from councils, how do you see that the change in the housing element might affect the ability of people who are leaving care to move on into to successful tenancies?
Well, as was highlighted earlier, there is an ongoing conversation around what exemptions will be in place for 18 to 21-year-olds, and we would, as Barnardo's, hope that there is as wide a group of exemptions as possible, particularly to address the needs of groups like care leavers. One of the things that I know is being explored coming out of the Children and Young People Scotland Act is whether Scotland needs to widen the definition of who is eligible for support as a care leaver. And this was a commitment that Aileen Campbell made to the committee at stage two, that that's something that would be explored. We could then end up in a situation where Scotland has a broader definition of eligibility for support as a care leaver, and it's not then clear how that would route back into any Westminster definition of care leaver for the purpose of an exemption to the general removal of housing benefit for 18 to 21-year-olds. So we've got a concern there about the mismatch. Obviously, our position is that we would like to see as many young people as possible who've been through the care system potentially eligible for support as care leavers, but we're then concerned that you could end up with two classes of care leaver, one care leaver who was eligible for support from corporate parents and local authorities, but not housing support through welfare payments, and another group who were eligible for housing support. So there's a big concern there about how that will play out in practice. But equally, as the convener highlighted, 16 and 17-year-olds in Scotland are treated as children under the terms of the Children and Young People Scotland Act. If they have a welfare need, they will have a named person. If they have a well-being need, then the named person has a responsibility to act and potentially move to a child's plan and targeted intervention. It's not clear what would happen if the well-being need arises from a lack of financial support coming from the UK welfare system, and how those systems will interact. And our concern is that the positive elements of the Children and Young People Scotland Act and that holistic model of support misses a crucial piece of the jigsaw if welfare payments aren't part of that conversation about how we address the well-being of 16 and 17-year-olds.
Does anyone else want to come in on that particular point? I'm going to open up to the committee, Ms. McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Convener, and that leads on very, very well for Mark Ballard's comments there. From my point of view, there's a briefing that I've got, and yes, I do hang on to all these briefings, John, especially the ones for Child Poverty Action Group that you produced in June. Well, it was revised in June, and it was basically, you know, you broke down the Scotland Act and all its clauses, you know, the additional powers and all its clauses and the impact that then has on people. What my question really is the thread that I see running through your reports and everybody's reports, and it leads into what Mark Ballard just said in his final remarks here, is about how incoherent the whole thing is. And then there's layers of incoherence in it, because there's then the incoherence that if you're a child in a family where you're a carer, if you're a child in a family where, you know, there's maybe you've got a disability. If you have a disability and you're an adult, and whether you've got somebody who's a carer for you in that household, if you're a woman, which is something we've taken a keen interest in this committee and the impact that then has. So you've got layers and layers and layers of incoherence in this whole system. And for us, looking at a future social security system for Scotland, how on earth do we make that work? Because, it's becoming...
absolutely obvious that you know, there's been no real thought put into the impact of a pick and mix style of powers and how that then has an impact on your ability to do your job and our ability to create a system that is actually a true social security system. Can you help?
Key to this, well, given this is the situation that we're in, we're looking at what, you know, we're trying to look at what powers are being devolved to the Scottish Parliament and what can be done within those powers and how they link to the bulk of social security powers that will remain reserved to Westminster. And key to that will be the intergovernmental working relations between the two governments, a commitment to make this work with the interests of claimants at the forefront of thinking through, not just looking at what works for the two governments, but actually making sure we're bringing in and thinking about this from the perspective of individuals, families who rely on social security, whether they're in work or out of work, and looking, making sure that we get systems in place that work. So we have flagged up there are in the existing system, one of the key issues, one of the key things that impacts on families is the problems with maladministration, with delays in benefit payments, with interactions between payments from different levels of government, whether it's housing benefit administered at local authority level, UK government social security payments. We've recently published a report that's looked at the whole kinship care issue as a key example of how it's really important to think about this from the point of view of the kinship carer, and not just a policy intent doesn't translate into additional support for, in this case, in a kinship carer, but looking ahead, individuals and families more generally, it needs to be thought through as to what will be the impact on, you know, from additional support through a Scottish benefit, what's going to be the impact of that in terms of UK social security support. So yes, these things need to be thought through very carefully, and at the heart of that needs to be thinking about what will be the administrative infrastructure for delivering the Scottish bit of the social security system. But I wouldn't want that to kind of detract from, I suppose, what there are very real, I think we've said all through, there are very real opportunities within those powers that are being devolved to the Scottish Parliament. And that, I suppose, what I'm hoping today's session might tease out is just how crucial social security is to reducing child poverty, to improving the well-being of children, to improving outcomes for children, and that we think about how we use these the powers that are being devolved in a way that contributes to the national ambitions that there are around those issues. So I was thinking about how important social security is. Demonstrated in three ways. Had some work done for us by the Institute of Social and Economic Research looking at the role that tax and benefit income transfers play in reducing child poverty across Europe. What's absolutely clear from that is that in just about all countries in Europe, child poverty is far higher. If you imagine what the levels of child poverty would be before tax and benefit transfers and the role of Social Security plays, it would be far higher. It's reduced significantly across Europe. Social Security plays a core role, not the only role, but a key role in reducing levels of child poverty. So what we need to think about is how do we use those powers that are coming to Scotland in order to make as big a contribution as we possibly can to preventing and reducing levels of child poverty. I suppose the other thing to say is that real progress has been made in the past in reducing levels of child poverty. So investment in child benefit, investment in tax credits all had a significant impact on reducing the numbers of children living in poverty in Scotland and across the UK. So we know that investing in social security where we can makes a big contribution to reducing child poverty and improving and alongside that, the evidence shows that improving children's well-being. And of course we have all the evidence now of what the impact is of cutting levels of benefits and social security support for families is in terms of the impact on their well-being, the forecast increases in child poverty. So I suppose it's about trying to work out, okay, how can we now use what powers we have to make a contribution to and I think there are within the limits, and given this is only a small amount of the social security system devolved, but through maybe get onto this, talking about top-ups, talking about administration of universal credit, talking about the housing element within universal credit, but actually making a big difference, a difference to children and families, and making sure that they do have the financial support they need to protect their children from poverty.
Maggie, I wonder if you can come in here, but I'm going to ask a wee supplementary just to focus this a wee bit more. Over the past few days, we've heard lots of pronouncements from the Prime Minister and the Chancellor on how they want to make work pay, and they're using this, I like to call it a fake living wage, because it doesn't meet any of the Resolution Foundation criteria for being an actual living wage of £7.20 is the mark to do that, to lift people out of poverty. But when you attach that to cuts to tax credits, when you look at what people would actually earn from that, it works out, I think, of an extra 7 pence per pound. That's all they make from it, and actually, for most families, it's about £2,000 a year on average cut to household incomes. And I know that there's a real serious impact on lone parents, and we've spoken to some lone parents on the committee and how that's affected. And I'm very, very involved in your organisation locally where I am, in the Transforming Lives programme that they do. And when I speak to some of the young mums and dads there, the real fear that they are now experiencing, because they feel that if they're working part-time and look after the kids, if there's then a disproportionate impact on tax credits, the impact that then has on the overall family budget and actually the ability of the family to stay together?
I'd like to sort of just flag up some figures actually about lone parents in particular in relation to your comments there. So the combined effect of the budget is going to, as you said, lead to particularly large losses for lone parents. And they've already been the household type which has been hardest hit by the previous tax and benefit changes under the previous government. And the the IFS estimates that single parent working for 20 hours a week on the minimum wage with two children under five will lose £1,709 a year by 2019. So that shows very clearly the impact of the so-called living wage increases and the cuts to welfare at the same time. So I think your point is absolutely right. And I think this raises an additional concern about the cuts. Well, not additional, but I suppose there are two prongs to it, really. There's the need to support people who are not in work, but there's the rising issue of in-work poverty, and I think those figures clearly show that the current cuts and the budget overall will actually push lone parents or more working lone parents into poverty. So I think that when we consider what we can do with the powers here, we have to think about those two things. We have to think about parents and children, carers, who for whatever reason their children are very young or they're looking after disabled children potentially or family members, what we can do to support them. But we also need to arrange the our top-ups, our additional benefits, whatever we want to do. We need to take into account how does that support people and provide incentives to stay in work. Because this isn't working at all for lone parents. There's just a really desperate situation. I just wanted to give a quick example. We recently done a survey of lone parents about the impact of welfare reform. It's not published yet, but I've got some initial comments and data. So this is just a sort of real-life example to go with those figures from the IFS. So here's a woman who says, I got a wage increase in April, but my tax credits have dropped, so I'm now £70 a month worse off. I've got no money towards my childcare, I've got zero working tax credits, and now it's eating into my child tax credit as well. I've got no housing benefit, even though I'm in a private rented house, and so I'm paying double what I might be if I was in a social housing, and half my wages go on rent. I can't manage like this. So that's just an example of these are cuts that are in place just now, so this is even before we talk about the forthcoming cuts in the budget that I just talked about. So yeah, we need to think about both those issues. I think is the key point I want to make. We need to look at work incentives, make work pay, and support people who are not working for whatever reason.
Yeah. Mark.
Yes, I wanted to come in on this as well, because Barnardo's and One Parent Family Scotland have been working together on some particular elements of the changes. In particular, the extension of conditionality for parents with a youngest child aged 3 and 4. At the moment, parents with a child under 5 do not have to do compulsory job search. That will change in the Welfare Reform and Work Bill, and parents with a child aged 3 and 4 will have to sign a claimant commitment and do compulsory job search and face sanctions if they fail to meet the terms of their claimant commitments. Now, many of the parents we work with, many of the lone parents in particular that One Parent Families Scotland work with, want to move into work, want a well-paid job that they can combine with their caring responsibilities. The barrier is not a lack of willingness on their part, it's the lack of appropriate jobs that they can combine effectively with their caring commitments. And our concern is that extending conditionality to parents with the youngest child aged 3 and 4 will inevitably lead to more of these parents facing benefit sanctions because they cannot find the work, because the childcare is not available or the childcare is not in the right place that enables them to combine the work that they might be able to find with their caring responsibilities. They will therefore face sanctions, and that's another example where the Scottish Government early years strategy, which is about supporting young children, making sure that every child gets the best possible start in life, could potentially be undermined if we have more and more parents, particularly lone parents with a child aged 3 and 4, facing benefit sanctions. And we know that the impact, particularly on young children, that echoes throughout the rest of their life is huge. That's the entire focus of the early year strategy, to build well-being and build resilience for, particularly for young children. And so there's a particular concern there, again, about the interaction between something that's going through Westminster policy and changes to UK legislation and the early year strategy in Scotland. And yes, as I'm sure that I know there are plenty of examples from families Barnardo's work with, Children First work with, and One Parent Families Scotland work with, of the existing impact of benefit sanctions when a parent has a child over 5. I think the committee can probably imagine what the impact would be if that regime is extended to parents with a child aged 3 and 4.
Convener, I probably could have loads and loads of questions on this, but I've only got one very final quick thing, and it's mainly, I've looked at some of the evidence and there's a couple of case studies, I think, let me see, it's a big submission. Yeah, it's for the Child Poverty Action Group again, John, and it's a couple of case studies. And mainly what I find, the theme is that how going to a food bank is becoming a normalised part of a support structure for some families, rather than it being an exception. And I just wonder if you can confirm that my thoughts are correct on that. That, you know, there's a case study there. It's a woman worried about the additional costs of the school holidays because the kids get a breakfast club voucher and a lunch voucher, and saying there's only one food bank in my area. But that fact that just thinking about forward to the summer holidays means that a food bank becomes a normal part of the support structure rather than something that should be an exception.
It should be an exception. It shouldn't need to happen at all. We should have a social security system that protects families when they hit hard times, whether they're sick, disabled, facing unemployment, meets the additional costs of children when they're not able to work as many hours as they might otherwise be able to. So it's an indictment of the failings in our current social security system that we're seeing the explosion in the use of food banks. I think we included that case study as an example of where actually that family is getting all the benefits and tax credits they're entitled to. So they're getting all the financial support. This wasn't an issue. There was no benefit delay. There was no sanction. There's no maladministration. And still, that person is struggling.
Circumstances of school holidays is created.
Exactly. The take away from the support that's available during the school term. So absolutely, on the other hand, we're also seeing a whole lot of families, and Mark's flagged this up, who are facing even more acute income crisis, who actually find themselves with no financial support, and again, that being a key trigger for use of food banks. So I think our aim, in terms of thinking about the future of social security in Scotland, our aim should be, well, how do we, within the limited powers that are coming to Scotland in relation to social security, use these powers with the ambition of making it that no family in Scotland would need to use a food bank. That should be the minimum ambition, actually, that's what we're aiming to do.
Agree with you, Peter.
Just to quickly follow up on the question of food banks, we've been doing work now for around about a year following the publication of some research that we did last year, so we published in January, February, and there's no doubt that there's a relationship between increased use of emergency food aid and the kinds of issues that John was talking about. I think also we need to remember that the problems of food insecurity are more widespread than the numbers of people turning up at food banks would suggest. So I think we need to bear that in mind. Your original question to John a minute ago was about coherence of the system. And I think John's response, and we need to hold on to this, was about the intergovernmental working, but I think also the working at local level, in Scottish level, for the future welfare system. And again, John's other point is about how do we make the future powers work to tackle poverty? And I think we do need to look at how we spend our resources in our welfare systems, how we make use of the additional powers to address some of these problems, because fundamentally, this is about inadequate incomes. That's why people are going to food banks. That's why, with small changes in people's situations, they find themselves below the breadline.
Okay. Just to add a figure, our latest statistics say that one in every 31 Citizens Advice Bureau clients need a food voucher, and that's up from one in 50 last year. And we're talking about how small changes can impact on those people, and I think small changes the other way around can actually really improve people's lives. So I think there's opportunity within the powers that are coming to Scotland to actually make those small changes, whether it's administratively or in terms of the amount of income that people have, that will help keep people away from needing a food parcel.
Thank you. Ms. McAlpine?
Thank you very much. Both Mark Ballard and Maggie Kelly illustrated changes at a UK level that are having an impact on families and increasing child poverty. And Mark, you gave the example of the parents of 3 to 4 year olds facing sanctions. Maggie talked about changes to tax credits. Both sanctions and tax credits are reserved to UK level, and we're not going to get any power over them at all. And we have already heard about the Scotland Bill, and we've taken evidence on attempts, the clauses that deal with where we can mitigate. There's been a lot of talk about top-ups and mitigation of these reserved benefits. But what's coming out from Westminster is that we're actually restricted in what we can do to mitigate these benefits. And in particular, I know that Carers Scotland and Inclusion Scotland have both suggested that the Scotland Bill will actually further restrict our ability to pay from the Scottish Welfare Fund, for example, if someone's being sanctioned. That's not enough for us on its own to pay out from the Scottish Welfare Fund. And we've taken evidence this morning on discretionary housing payments and how we're actually restricted and what we can do with them. So I just think that I wondered if you could comment on the fact that there's been a lot of talk about, you know, top-ups and new benefits, but when it actually comes to these really serious changes being made at a UK level, we're actually quite restricted in what we can do with the new powers.
I couldn't agree more that certainly with regard to sanctions, I think that's a huge stumbling block for us in trying to put together a coherent, as we heard earlier, was a big issue, a coherent system, and that as long as we have the current sanctioning regime, that is very, very problematic. But I think that, having said that, I think we have to kind of try and think creatively about what we can do to deal with the situation of sanctions. I mean, in terms of just improving people's basic level of entitlement, I think that that goes a long way to preventing people from falling into such serious crisis if they do get sanctioned. So I think the idea of being able to use top-ups, for example, on reserved benefits cushions people, and it's a very important measure to tackle poverty, and particularly child poverty in general. So I think we should definitely be looking at how to do that, what benefits we might want to top up. I would suggest that, you know, we should definitely look at topping up child benefits. We should look at the rate of benefits and look at making sure that it keeps up with inflation, because that's the basic problem, is that, you know, the cost of living is going up and benefits are, have either, you know, are not being uprated in line with inflation, or in many cases, particularly children's benefits, have been frozen for a number of years at a low level. So
could you explain how you think we can do that? How, in practical terms, how can we top up child benefit?
Well, I think, I mean, we have to wait and see what the final result of the bill is, and we're still talking about something that's in the making. So I can't give you 100%, you know, this is exactly how we're going to do it, because we don't have the powers in front of us to kind of look at the detail. But I think that certainly we would, you know, we would definitely be right to start looking at the powers overall and look at potentially a more progressive taxation system, which would then fund some of those top-ups, I think, would be definitely worth looking at, because although, as I say, sanctions are something that we're to some extent stuck with, although not entirely. I'll say a little bit more about that in a minute, but providing a better cushion for people overall and tackling poverty in general for people, and in particular, obviously, lone parents and children, is something that we should be focusing on. So, I mean, I'm not going to talk about the sort of detail of the bill and in particular, but I think that, you know, there are powers there which say that we should be able to top up reserve benefits. And there are powers there within the universal credit section which says that we should be able to look at, for example, the local housing allowance. So the example I gave of the woman earlier on who was saying half my rent is going on... half my wages, sorry, are going on rent. That's a case study I gave. I mean, that's a typical example of somebody who really could benefit from assistance within the universal credit housing element.
Universal credit?
There'll be some... My understanding is...
We don't have powers over the housing element either. We've only got powers over discretionary housing payments, and we've already heard how we can only use... We're actually restricted in using them, you know, when somebody loses their housing benefit, they lose their entitlement to discretionary housing payments. So we actually... I mean, I kind of admire your optimism in a sense, but, you know, like, I'm afraid I think certainly the evidence that we've received at this committee doesn't tend to back up.
Can I just, sorry, John, then I'll let you go, John. I just wanted to say something about the issue of sanctions in particular. And I think that you're absolutely right that they're a huge stumbling block and it is a problematic situation as far as Scotland's concerned. What do we do about that? I just wanted to flag up the fact that one of the powers that's coming to Scotland is over the work programme. And so, obviously, that's very problematic if Scotland's in charge of the work programme and we've still got sanctioning. So I think we really need to look very, very carefully at what we can do within those powers over the work programme to minimise the use of sanctions as far as we possibly can. And that might... I can see you're shaking your head. But I think what we need to consider is that we've got powers in Scotland to run that programme. And so we're in a position, for example, to start training people. One of the issues for lone parents in terms of sanctioning is that the lone parents' regulations around discretion are just not used at all. So one of the first things we can do is set up some training for those people that are required to refer people sanctioning, to actually get them to implement the regulations properly. I mean, that's not even being done. So that's just one example. There's quite a few more that I could talk about, but that's just an example of how we could dramatically reduce the number of lone parents that are being sanctioned through that particular programme.
Element, but I just wonder, you know, like we're actually only seeing a tiny amount at the moment of the effect of universal credit, even in the pilot areas. Like I covered Dumfries, and I've been told Dumfries is a pilot, but I've been done in a very, very incremental way. So we're not actually seeing the effects of universal credit even in the pilot areas. So we all know that universal credit contains a much higher level of conditionality. So when it's fully rolled out, I mean, like the conditionality will be more than we've ever seen before, which means more sanctions than we've ever seen before. So I can't see how that's, you know, mitigated by, you know, the example that you give, which will maybe, you know, under certain circumstances help some people, but is completely outweighed when universal credit's rolled out across the country.
I mean, I do agree that the bill that we're looking at in the Parliament is horrendous, and Mark's already talked about the issue for lone parents with three-year-old children, and you know that is a disaster in the making, really, if we look at the impact already on lone parents. I suppose all I'm saying is, I'm not at all being optimistic about this, what I'm saying is that we should use the powers that we've got and consider in detail, you know, what we could do, and one of the things that we could do, for example, is, you know, train people up to actually abide by the law as it stands, you know, for example. Another thing we should do is we should be training them up to consider whether or not they're meeting human rights requirements in international law. You know, and that's something that we could be saying to providers when we take over the work programme. You know, this is what we want you to do. You want to abide by these regulations. And to my mind, if you look at those regulations, it says that, you know, the well-being of the child should not be impacted negatively. To my mind, it would lead me to the conclusion that that family shouldn't be sanctioned. Now, I don't see why we can't do that. So I think, you know, there's a lot more to be considered about it, but I'm just sort of throwing it in as a practical suggestion about one way that we could really challenge the UK government on sanctions in terms of saying, well, actually, you know, there are other sorts of legislation that we should be looking at, and we are determined in Scotland to really, you know, look at these in detail and enforce them here, insofar as we're able to. Obviously, I take your point that, you know, we're not, we don't have, you know, carte blanche control of the whole situation, but I think we should make a stand on those issues.
Can I just, echo that? No, that's, that, you know, we would certainly never underestimate the scale of the damage that's been done to families in Scotland by the current approach to Social Security, the cuts, the so-called reforms, but essentially the cuts to the value of benefits and tax credits that are going to be wrapped up into the new universal credit, the additional conditionality, the sanctions, the damage that's doing. But at the same time, I wouldn't want that to blind us to what the opportunities that are presenting themselves to us through the Scotland Bill, as it's currently drafted, and you mentioned top-up benefits and also the housing element of universal credit. So within the housing element of universal credit, as we understand it, the powers that the Scottish Parliament have could make a real meaningful difference. I mean, it should allow us to actually properly abolish the bedroom tax by getting rid of the under-occupancy charge. Control over local housing allowances could be used to, which are used to calculate housing benefit in the private rented sector, could be used to, or could be adjusted to reflect real rents in the private sector, as opposed to the situation we have currently, where there's been a break between what eligible rents are for housing benefit in the private rented sector and actual increases in levels of rent in the rental market. So we've seen switch to CPI uprating, a 1% cap on uprating, and now proposed freeze on uprating of local housing allowances. That, my understanding is, will now be within the competence of the Scottish Parliament, which can take a different approach and ensure that eligible rents within universal credit reflect actual rents in the private rented sector. Another example we've identified where some improvement could be made there is where there's been a lot of focus on the social rented sector, quite understandably, but in the private rented sector, there's sort of the equivalent of the bedroom tax there anyway, which means that you're only eligible for rooms that you're deemed as eligible for, not the number of rooms that you need. So, for example, parents with shared care only getting enough housing benefit to cover the costs of a one-bedroom flat, where actually they need a two-bedroom flat in order to have a room free for a child half the week. Again, our understanding is within with control over the housing element of universal credit, that can be addressed here in Scotland. So I think now, in the overall scale of things, these means seem minor, but actually they could be really important and make a real difference to individual families and help contribute to ensuring that the support with the cost of housing and better meet the needs of families in Scotland and contribute to reducing child poverty, because housing costs are have a major impact on what's then left for families to pay for the other essentials on a day-to-day basis. In terms of top-ups, again, the detail of this, but my understanding of the Scotland Bill is that it will give the Scottish Parliament the competence to legislate for additional payments to, for example, all families in receipt of child benefits, an additional payment perhaps to reflect inflation and the real rising costs of bringing up a child in Scotland and to make what will be difficult decisions given but looking at the overall Scottish budget, looking at the overall revenue raising powers that the Parliament has and saying yes, we will use these powers to prioritise children and families and to help contribute to that goal that I think is shared widely across the Parliament of improving children's outcomes and of reducing child poverty. So without taking away anything from the scale of the damage that's been done, there are real opportunities, I think, here that we don't want to lose sight of, and I hope we would see the Parliament use those powers that do come to make the biggest possible impact on the lives of children and families here in Scotland.
Mr. Dryburgh, just very quickly.
I think it's worth flagging up that some mitigation has already happened even without the Scotland Bill. We've had the Scottish Welfare Fund, where the Scottish Government's topped up the funding to make sure it reaches enough people. The council tax reduction scheme, where again the Scottish Government's topped up the funding, and I know in England that wasn't done and that had a big impact on vulnerable people in England. The Scottish Government provided mitigation funding for advice through Citizens Advice Bureau that allowed us to give advice on 50,000 more issues than we would have done otherwise, and that enabled a client financial gain of around 17.5 million pounds for those people. And there's also the bedroom tax, where the Scottish Government was able to use what was effectively a top-up discretionary fund to mitigate the worst of impact for vulnerable people. And it's worth flagging up as well that universal credit will impact on, or at least 700,000 households will be on universal credit by 2019. And that's 700,000 people that could be benefited from if the Scottish Government uses its powers over payment frequency to allow them to budget better. On disabled people and carers, there are over 200,000 people that claim DLA in Scotland. If the Scottish Government get their designs right for disability benefits, then it's 200,000 people that could be benefited. So there's plenty of opportunity within what powers we have and in the Scotland Bill as well. But it's really, just to add, it's really important the Scotland Bill is right to make sure that the Scottish Government isn't inhibited in what it can actually do.
Mr. Ballard,
I'd like to emphasise again the point that John Dickey made earlier about the importance of intergovernmental relationships in making this work. Westminster is taking a decision to partially devolve some elements of welfare to the Scottish Parliament. That will require them to develop a new relationship. Maggie Kelly talked about the implications of devolving responsibility for employment training programmes and how that will require new relationships. The UK Prime Minister has talked about plans for new forms of support for young people, where young people will, after a period of, I think, 6 months, be offered either a community job or a training or college place. If that's going to happen in Scotland, it will require a new relationship with the Scottish Government, since colleges are the responsibility of the Scottish Government, not the responsibility of Westminster. So there'll have to be new relationships. And this may be optimistic, but on the question of sanctions, there is a difference between sanctions legislation and sanctions as they are applied in practice. There is discretion about how you apply sanctions, and I would hope that part of that new relationship that Westminster has chosen to have through partially devolving responsibility for welfare would open up an opportunity for a conversation not about the legal structure for sanctions, which would be common across the UK, but a conversation about how, in practice, on a day-to-day basis, those legal regulations are applied in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move to Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Much of the discussion that we've had this morning has been round about areas which will remain reserved to Westminster in terms of universal credit, in terms of conditionality, in terms of tax credits and the disaster that's about to happen there, affecting 200,000 families in Scotland, 346,000 children, more children going into poverty. And we've heard from Mr. Dryburgh about what has already been achieved here in terms of mitigation with the Scottish Welfare Fund, council tax reduction, and the bedroom tax. And what we're talking about in some of the other areas today seems to me just like more mitigation in some regards, and not the ambition to create a social security system that actually works for all, which provides a real safety net for all, because we're only getting part of these things devolved. And even then, we're going to have a veto over us in terms of certain things which we won't be allowed to do. So my question is quite simply this. Does the Scotland Bill give the Scottish Government and this Parliament enough powers to have an effective and fair social security system? And we can start with Mr. Ballard, please.
Barnardo's concern, I think, rooted back to the points that Christina McKelvey made, that the important thing for the children, young people and families we work with is a coherent system. And it's coherence that matters. That's why we welcomed the fact that employability was coming to the Scottish Parliament. But our submission to the Smith Commission highlighted that the point for us was that it should be coherent. A case could be made, potentially, a case could have been made for responsibility for colleges going and training going to Westminster. For Barnardo's, for our concern for families, the important thing is that we have a system that is as coherent as possible from the point of view of the children and the families and the young people who need that system. So therefore, we would support anything that brings greater coherence, because that should be the bottom line. If we want a welfare system that works for those who need it, it needs to avoid as far as possible the complications that come when you have different parliaments responsible for different elements. So coherence is what we need, and our concern about the partial devolution is that it has the potential to increase incoherence for some of the reasons that Maggie Kelly described earlier, where you get an interface between a work programme and a sanctions regime which doesn't work effectively for anybody, in anybody's terms, whether it's the interests of the policy direction being taken by Westminster or the policy direction being taken by the Scottish Parliament. And that's why the key issue for us has always been in the constitutional position that we... Barnardo's does not take a position on the constitutional questions. What we look for, what we hope for, is a system that is coherent from the point of view of those who need it. And that should be our bottom line.
If it's incoherent, then it's going to be ineffective, is it not?
There's more danger that it's going to be ineffective, but as I highlighted earlier, given our challenge would be if Westminster has taken a decision to partially devolve some areas, how are we going to put in place the intergovernmental frameworks and the new ways of working which will minimise the impact on vulnerable children and families of any incoherence? So the challenge comes back to us to what is in the interests of vulnerable children and families. If a decision is taken about a particular structure of powers, how are those parliaments going to interact effectively in the interests of delivering something that looks as coherent as possible from the point of view of vulnerable children and families? So parliaments can cooperate, the DWP can cooperate even more effectively with that new architecture I talked about around the Children and Young People Scotland Act. Even if it's not a legal duty, there's nothing to stop people working together more effectively if they share an ethos of supporting those in need.
Well, let's hope that that some of the wrangling doesn't go as on as long as it normally does in these circumstances. You've got some optimism that, unfortunately, I don't entirely share, Mr. Ballard. Ms. McLaughlin, do you think that with the powers that we're getting, we can create an effective and fair social security system in Scotland?
Well, Children First wouldn't be able to make any comment on the actual framework or the powers that are devolved, but again, we would echo that we would hope for a bottom-up approach which takes into account the hidden vulnerabilities of families, the barriers that families face, and also the different structures of families. John mentioned where there's shared care. Also, we have concerns over kinship care, single-parent families also. So what we would hope that... We're hoping for a different approach to, rather than when we're talking about mitigation and how can we protect ourselves, a more focus on person-centred, a holistic approach, a focus on well-being and how we can support that.
To have that kind of person-centred approach, if you don't control all aspects of the effects that various things are having in that person's life?
No, of course, but what we would be looking for is that we are at least recognising the difficulties that our families are facing and the knock-on effects that it has. It's not just a lack of money, a lack of food. It's ongoing trauma, how this can impact in children. We're hoping to build resilience within families and look beyond just what does the money mean, what does not having food mean, how does this affect attachment, and then what are the knock-on effects for other costs such as health, social care.
But it's difficult to build resilience in a group if they're haven't got the cash in their pocket and they haven't got grub in their bellies, I would say.
No, and that's it. Certainly agree with that. And Maggie mentioned creative approaches. Certainly looking at, we would hope, administrative, clearer systems. It's easier for families to navigate. Clearer language is an easier system for people to interact with, and training was mentioned also. But again, the language that you use, the approach that we are allowed to take, would go some way to overcoming the protectors of the public purse. And we would hope that would build capacity within families.
Mr. Dickie, an effective and fair social security system, can we do it with this division of power?
I think with the political will from both governments and the right approach to social security, yes. The reality is that social security is now, in terms of what's on the table for devolution, will become a shared responsibility between the Scottish Parliament and the UK Parliament. As I've said before, it's a limited scope within what's been devolved to Scotland. But I would hope that with the new powers around those bits of social security that are being devolved, that the Scottish Parliament, I suppose, can take a lead and demonstrate what is possible when you take a different, more principled approach to social security reform, and that some of the values and principles that have been agreed by many people, including through the Scottish Campaign on Welfare Reform, many of us have been members of, that a set of principles that benefits should be adequate to prevent people from falling into poverty, that the social security system should treat people with dignity and respect, that the system should be simplified through more use of, through more use of universal and non-means-tested benefits, and that there should be additional investment to ensure that people are able to participate, that Social Security allows people to participate fully in society. it's going to be limited what's possible within within Scotland and within the Scottish Parliament, but there are opportunities to demonstrate the ambition for a social security system that would be in line with those principles, at least within those elements of social security that are being devolved. And it will rely, as we've already said, on the importance of getting working relationships with the UK government to ensure that the mechanisms and the administrative infrastructure for delivering those bits of social security that are devolved to Scotland are got right, so that people are able to access the support they're entitled to, wherever, whoever, whichever level of government, local, Scottish or UK government, is responsible for that financial support.
You talked about a shared power. Do you think that it's right that one of the partners should have the right of veto over the other if it's shared powers?
This is a shared space. I mean, I'm not sure about the language of vetoes. Clearly, decisions will need to be made so that the system operates. Where, for example, universal credit remains a reserve benefit, but housing element of universal credit, there'll be devolved powers around.
The Westminster
governments need to come to agreement on how that's going to work in the interests of families in Scotland.
I'm talking about the Westminster's right of veto over decisions that we take about top-up benefits. If we, do you think that Westminster should have a power of veto over us in that regard?
As I understand it, the Scottish Parliament should have the power to make additional payments to top-up reserved benefits, and the mechanism of that will need to be agreed
Secretary
with the UK
of
government.
State.
It certainly shouldn't be vetoed.
No. With the agreement of the Secretary of State, it says in the bill, who... I would say that's a power of veto. Do you think that should be a power of veto?
I would hope it's not. I would hope that's not seen as a power. I would hope that's not used as a power of veto, but rather used as a mechanism for ensuring the administrative infrastructure is in place to allow the Scottish Parliament to make a top-up payment, for example, to child benefits.
Convener, if I could just get the other three very quickly.
Yes, I know Mr. Kelly wants to come in particular. So
their view, an effective and fair social security system. Can we do that with the vast bulk of these powers being retained in London?
Just briefly, following on from what John said, OPFS are a member of Scottish Campaign on Welfare Reform, and I think you've heard from John that what we want to see is those key principles to be the foundation for any welfare benefit system that we have here in Scotland. And I think that it's clear, listening to our discussion this morning, that because the devolution has got lots of ragged edges between various parts of it, that creates potential holes that people can fall through, basically. And there's clearly, to my mind, a major issue around the whole issue of passporting, where you've got one benefit, which is a reserve benefit, and the other one is a Scottish-administered, a devolved benefit. And clearly already passporting causes quite a lot of problems for people, and there will need to be lots more of it now that we've got this newly devolved powers. And so I think that Mark and others comment about the need for a better working relationship between governments is going to become even more important because of this passporting issue, amongst many issues, but that is particularly worrying for me. So there's the issue of it being piecemeal and people falling down the cracks in the middle. But there's also, one of the key things that we say as SCOUR is that we want benefits to be simplified, and of course many of the cuts that we've seen introduced are complicating things further, and so is conditionality in my mind. It's a hugely complicated thing. But we are, I think, with some of the powers that we have, able to perhaps simplify some of the things. So rather than thinking about discretionary housing payments, I think we should be talking about introducing measures to abandon the bedroom tax in Scotland. And that would be a much simpler and a better system than what we've got at the moment. And I know you're saying we can't. I think that's, I think my understanding of the bill is that there is a power to do that at the moment. But anyway...
And I don't dispute that. We can abolish the bedroom tax with the power that we get. But the thing is that the Secretary of State still has the right of veto
over various
things.
I know, yes. No, I take your point about that. But setting that aside for a minute, I suppose the example I'm giving is that, here is one of the powers, notwithstanding the veto issue,
where we can simplify the benefit system instead of people, you know, needing to make an actual claim for a discretionary housing payment. Lots of people don't manage to do that for various reasons. They might be in crisis, so on and so forth. That's a temporary mitigation. This is something that could be a permanent part of a more simplified and a better benefit system, which is about rights rather than discretionary handouts, I would say, is something that we should be looking at as far as possible. You know, looking at, you know, making sure that people have basic entitlements, not looking at discretionary payments. But I agree that the issue about whether or not there's a veto, I mean, obviously we could discuss that quite a lot. And I think that Smith didn't say that there ought to be a veto, as far as I know. And I think that that wouldn't be a very helpful way, shall I put it, of the two governments proceeding. So I think that's probably all I'm going to say about that. I mean, the only other thing, I suppose, I would just like to reiterate my point about sanctions. And I do think that we shouldn't just sit...
I'm really sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We are running out of time. I've got another member who wants in, and Mr. Kelly and Mr. Dryburgh, I'm sure, want to respond to Mr. Stewart as well. Sorry about that.
That's no problem.
It's okay. So you asked a very direct question, Mr. Stewart, about can the powers that are coming create an effective and fair framework for social security in Scotland and to tackle poverty. And I think, as you've heard, almost all of us put in evidence to the Smith Commission which was based on a coherent approach. So we had said that the powers over social security, over welfare that should be devolved to Scotland should be coherent. So we said no matter what. So we didn't take the approach that some organisations did and said all welfare. So we said whatever the package, then it needs to be coherent. So for working age benefits, then it should be all working age benefits. And that isn't what we've got. So I think the powers that we have ironically make things more difficult. As Maggie said, you know, to have a simplified system is what most of our goal would be. It was the goal that was set out when universal credit was first mooted. This was a new benefit that would harmonise other benefits, that would be a simplified system for people to move through far more easily. And ironically, by the way that we've divided up powers, that we will divide up powers, it will actually make things more complex. I think it will make things, it's the kind of discussion that we're having here, we're talking about how will things interact, how will people see their way through that system, and I think that needs to be our focus, is how do we work with the powers that we have to make sure that people's experience of those new powers, of the new benefits, whatever we choose to do with them, is as seamless as is possible. The thing, I guess, there's two key points about people's experience of the social security system. One is about, as you said yourself, the money that they have in their pocket. What can they do with that? Is it an adequate income or is it not? We have potentially some limited powers through further devolution, to address some of those issues. And I think we need to look seriously at the issues around child benefit and topping up child benefit. I know we haven't quite answered the question today. I know that Paul Spicker has produced some interesting information on how we could potentially use the topping up powers around child benefit. And I think we need to look at that seriously. But the other question, so there's the income dimension. There's also people's experience of their interaction with the welfare system, the social security system on a day-to-day basis. And that's certainly something that I think all of us hear back all the time. People don't just talk to us about their low income. They talk about the consequences of it, but they talk about their interaction with the services. And that's something that I think through the use of new powers, we can start to change. And Keith had said earlier about small changes that can improve people's lives. Those are small changes that people talk to us about all the time, about being treated with dignity and respect, whatever the service is that they're receiving. And I think that's something that, going forward from this this inquiry, that we need to have quite clearly in the use of new powers in a future social security bill in Scotland. We need to be clear that people are being treated with dignity and respect, whatever benefits they're receiving.
Beener, can I just say that in terms of dignity and respect, an amendment from myself and the Scottish Welfare Fund Bill hopefully will be a trailblazer and will remain in all other social security bills that we have. My fear is that while we treat folk with dignity and respect, while we are dealing with Scottish aspects, that may not be the case when folks are dealing with the DWP and the reserve powers.
Okay, thank you. Can I go to Mr. Driver and then to Mr. Bibby, please? Thanks.
Okay, my short answer would be yes, but it depends on a number of different factors, such as the UK government and Scottish government being able to work together and improve the administration of the system, to treat each other as partners in that shared space. It depends on how the Scottish government uses its powers to make sure that it's using its powers to the to maximum benefit of the claimants that are going to be affected. And I think it depends as well on treating social security as not just benefits, it's the overall welfare of an individual, of families. So, you know, it includes things like social care costs, social housing. So it's to make sure that the powers that the Scottish government are going to have actually works alongside the housing powers it has, alongside social care and health powers it has, to make sure, because if you're a vulnerable person, it doesn't matter who helps you, it matters that you're helped. So it's contingent on the Scottish Government to make sure it fits in with the overall powers that it currently has.
Mr. Bibby?
Thanks, Convener. It was mentioned earlier the case study of families struggling during school holidays. Renfrewshire Council has initiated a scheme where they'll be providing school meals to those in poverty during school holidays. Just wondered if that's something the panel would welcome. Also, Maggie Kelly mentioned the issue about progressive taxation. Obviously, if we're talking about coherence, the tax and the benefit system are obviously very linked. With powers over income tax being devolved, would your organisation support redistribution through the tax system, a more progressive taxation system, for example, raising the top rate of tax to fund initiatives that would help people, whether that be in education or other initiatives?
I probably can't comment on a specific proposal around more progressive taxation, but I certainly can say that I think that in terms of the new powers that are coming to Scottish Parliament, I think that when we're considering welfare and indeed other measures around education, training, so on and so forth, as you know, OPFS are very much involved in employability, that we need to consider the package overall, and that includes taxation, and that we need to consider the long-term impacts of poverty on children and families, and basically look at, I mean, we've been focusing quite rightly on individuals here and the impact on them, but we also need to think about the costs of poverty. And, you know, if we don't spend the money on supporting families in crisis on low incomes, then we have costs of homelessness, we have NHS bills go up because of crises due to ill health, all these sorts of things. So I suppose my plea is that we need to consider the powers overall, including taxation, but with a view to thinking about the overall cost of poverty to society as well as to the individual, and that's something that we're very much concerned about. So that's, I think, you know, all I can say about the need for progressive taxation is to support individuals, but also to make all the other policies that we have around homelessness, around housing, around healthcare, and particularly for children, getting it right for every child, early intervention. Those things don't work, I think, as Mark said earlier on, if, you know, people haven't got food to put on the table. So we need to look at it in the round.
Does anyone else want to come in on that point? Yeah, Mr. Driver.
I would say that a better social security system doesn't need to be a more generous one. You don't need to spend more money on it. You have to make sure you're spending in the right places. You're making sure the people that require the support get that support, and that you improve the administration, because I think a lot of the costs that involve for the system and for individuals is the poor administration. So if you improve that, you could actually have a much better system without needing more taxation. But I would echo that you do need to look at it in the round to make sure that funding goes into the right places. And in terms of your point on school meals and school holidays, I think it's a good example of where people are okay, they're released most of the year, but then there are gaps in the system. So that's something the Scottish example of what the Scottish Government could look at in terms of putting funding where, you know, the crisis points, the pinch points, where there are gaps. And that's the kinds of things that top-ups or discretionary payments can be used for.
Mr. Ballard?
Yes, I think Neil Bibby gave one really good example, but there's lots of other fantastic work being done at a local level to address child poverty by local authorities in Scotland, often working in partnership with the local voluntary sector. And I'd like to highlight the role of the Scottish Child Poverty Strategy, which should be one of the key ways that different examples of good practice are brought together to make sure that there is the learning from what's happening at a local level, and that can be effectively reproduced Scotland-wide. And again, harking back to the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, one of the things that Barnardo's welcomed was the general requirement to take account of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, and particularly Article 27 of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, that a standard of living which is good enough to meet the physical and social needs of a child is a right of every child. And we hope to see every element of Scottish Government, the Scottish Government itself, local authorities, actually embody that right going forward in everything they do.
Yeah, Mr. Dickie.
Yes. Well, I mean, two things on the support with costs of food during the school holidays and the initiative that Mr. Bibby flagged up. Again, yeah, I think very welcome and looking at other ways, but I think it's looking at the cost of school holidays across the piece as well, not just meals, but costs of additional childcare, costs of access to holiday activities. And I think you can actually link some of these things together and look at, well, how can we ensure that by providing a free meal during the an activity programme, that helps to bring young people into that activity programme during the school holidays, but also ensures that they've got a decent meal at least at some point during the day. So those kind of approaches, I think, very welcome. We're doing some work at the moment with Glasgow Life and partners in Glasgow, looking at the cost of the school holidays. So we did research over this summer holiday period, and there was no question that additional costs of food, additional costs of childcare, additional costs of activities all put a huge pressure on families. So finding ways to remove those financial barriers would be very welcome. And absolutely, we do need to see, I think I flagged up earlier, the role that tax and benefits plays in preventing and reducing levels of child poverty. It's redistribution through the tax and benefit system that helps to bring levels of child poverty down in almost every European country that there is. And we do need to look at ways of doing that more effectively. Scotland's an extraordinarily wealthy country. There is huge resources here. We need to look at those as well as look at the social security powers that are coming to Scotland, look at the existing tax powers and the new tax powers to look at how we can harness that wealth and ensure that those who are able to are making a fairer contribution to ensuring none of our children grow up in poverty and actually preventing those additional costs that build up to society and to us all as a result of child poverty. But I think it's not just about redistribution from those with resources and wealth to those less. So it's actually redistribution across the life course as well, that there's certain points in our lives where we incur additional costs as a result of bringing up children, and we potentially very often lose some of our income as well, as we have to give up some of our work time in order to provide for our children. So additional costs, lower incomes, and the tax and benefit system is a way of redistributing resources across the life course. So it's not just about transferring resources from the rich to the poor, it's for ensuring that we're all investing and ensuring ourselves for the realities of the costs that life imposes on us in such a way as at certain points we don't leave people, and particularly children, without the resources they need for a decent standard of living.
Okay. Can I thank everybody for taking part today? You've given us a great amount of food for thought in terms of what's happening, and you've just mentioned human rights, and of course there's proposals to change the Human Rights Bill as well, which I'm sure will come under further scrutiny within the Scottish Parliament as well. But if there is anything that we haven't covered that's not in your submissions that you do want to highlight to the committee, please feel free to follow up and write to us. We're about to move into private session to discuss our post-Christmas work programme and review the evidence heard today. This is the last meeting before October recess, and our next meeting will be on the 27th of October. Where we will continue to take oral evidence into an inquiry into the future delivery of social security in Scotland. And I'll now move into private session. Thank you very much.